Welcome, and let's go ahead and get our stuff started today. So we're back for session 13 of CE220C. This is all about parametric design and modeling. And today we're going to be taking a look at really how we can continue to flex different objects using the Dynamo kind of scripting language. And we're going to particularly be looking at list maps as a way of being able to go through and test a lot of different values and really quickly get results back and sort of see what those results would be for a variety of different input values. So list maps are really going to become one of our big friends as we go through and continue to evaluate lots of objects. And as we kind of think about the examples we're going to approach today, we're going to start by just looking at that example of a simple box. And could we go through and select some parameter of the simple box, just pulling out its volume and its area, just sort of get a feel for how this is working. But then we're going to quickly move into another example, which is very parallel, but a lot more interesting, that of a large twisting tower. And the twisting tower you'll see is actually very similar to the Shanghai Tower in Shanghai. It's a very kind of cool, kind of twisting triangle shape that's really kind of fun. We're then going to go ahead and say, how can we go through and use list map in two different ways? One way is to really go through and evaluate a whole lot of different panel surfaces to do that solar analysis, so looking at a bunch of panels on a roof or on our curving surface, and we can evaluate each of them using the solar analysis tool to kind of figure out what the insulation value is, so how much sunlight we can get on those, very similar to like what you're doing in the assignment. And finally, we're going to go through and just try varying overall input parameters. So not only evaluating the individual panels, but saying, what if we reshape the entire surface, either changing its length or changing its rotation, something like that. So these are all things that are sort of just variations on how you can use the list map to go through and evaluate a lot of different options. Okay. So in terms of where we were and where we're coming to, let's go ahead. Actually, I should introduce myself, just so you guys know, too. So hi. Welcome. It's nice to have you. I'm Glenn, teaching here in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering. And this class sort of positions itself in, there's a whole sequence of classes that are all about building modeling, which are good for students who are thinking about creating buildings, either in the architecture sense or the civil engineering sense. In particular, what this class is all about is how we can go through and kind of use these programmatic scripting languages to kind of generate an awful lot of different alternatives to consider as part of our design, as opposed to just thinking about a single design being there. So this is kind of where programming meets kind of the civil engineering side of things. Okay. Let's go ahead and get ourselves started here. Okay, so in terms of a recap of where we were last time, we spent some time in the last few sessions looking at the solar analysis tool, which we decided was a little bit better than going through just computing vectors to figure out how the sun was hitting our surfaces. And then we started looking at how we could go through and, for a single parametric surface, just go through and use the solar analysis tool to go through and create an overall evaluation value for that surface to say, how strong was it? By taking all the solar insulation values and either averaging them together or saying that we're going to choose the highest, something like that. And we sort of dove into the whole notion of the simple box and could we use the list map to vary some parameters to go through and test it. Now, that actually worked out pretty well, but we sort of ended right on the spot where it has a hitch in its get along, and that is as we go through and we try to flex the simple box, as we change the parameters and change the box, if we try to get the parameters, so get the values before the box has a chance to change, you actually end up with a little bit of an infinite loop there. It has trouble and kind of just like cycles. So let me go ahead and open up example 12, or okay, it's 13.1. I'm off there. But, well, actually it's probably, hang on. If you go to the folder, yeah, it actually says 13.1 there. Okay, let's go ahead and go to 13.1 and, hey Rami, let's go ahead and open that up and take a look. I'll just go ahead and fix these as we go. So coming back over to Revit. Let me close up some of these existing ones just because you don't want to be seeing all those and it will slow down my machine. Instead, I'll open up and go on out there to our winter 2016 folder, say session 13, and then in session 13, let's go for 13.1, which is our little simple box. Again, the reason we start with the simple box is the simple box is so simple. As we go through and change something like its height or width or some variable or value that we want to go through and try varying on it, we ought to be able to predict its behavior. So what we've been doing is taking that little simple box and just changing its height. For example, right now the height is set to a height of 50. Okay. If we go through and we start varying that, if we start varying it 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, all the way up through 100, what should happen is both the gross surface area and the volume should change. And what we're doing is really using Revit as a calculator. And in the case of a simple box, it's not all that exciting about what it does because you could probably do just about the same. But for the next example, you'll see where we have a twisting mass, it gets a little bit more interesting to try and figure out what's going on. So we're going to take that box and just programmatically say, what if we varied it from 10 feet tall to 20 feet tall? And just rather than doing this manually, go through and try doing that programmatically. Okay, so to make that happen, let's go ahead and open up the Dynamo scripting environment, and we'll just take a look at the equivalent script that's going to do just what I did manually. So under the Add-ins tab, we'll go to Dynamo. I will open, and let me go back to 13.1, and I'm going to start with just this whole notion of a simple box, single output. That's having a little trouble back in there. Let me go down and we can close that up and reopen Revit just so I don't have that little error message hanging in the background. For our guests, just so you know, what we're doing is we're working the tool for Autodesk Revit, which is for the building industry, like one of the standard ways of doing 3D modeling. You may hear a lot about AutoCAD and some tools that are very useful for like doing drafting work. When it comes to doing building work, we often use a tool called Revit, which is very similar to AutoCAD. Hey, welcome back. You made it. The polar vortex got people. The Revit environment is really good for modeling building elements. So let's go ahead and open that up. Again, I'll open up my 12.1 example. And we'll open up Dynamo, the scripting environment. So again, out there, we'll start with just this notion of our simple box. Now, the Dynamo scripting environment has all these nodes that we're going to go through and use to sort of try to vary some different things. In this simple little graph that we're looking at right now, I'm going to start by selecting a model element, selecting that big old element, and then I'm just basically going to say that I want to change its height value. So what I'm going to do is set up a whole series of different values that I can use to test against that. Let me go ahead and zoom this up a little bit so you can see that better. So when it comes time to select an element, what we'll do is just click that, choose that element over there. Let me do that without the alerts popping up right there. Okay, I've selected a single element. That looks fine. What I'm going to do is, in terms of creating a series of different values, is use the code block notation to create a range of values from 10 to 50 that vary by 10. So that's going to create something that will be 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Just create a simple series. If I go through and run this, you'll see that'll generate a list, which is 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. And what we're going to do is actually go through and plug that in to a function that computes the surface area. So this is the list of values. And when we say list map, it always starts with the notion of a list. So I'm going to feed that list in to this node called ListMap. The other half of the ListMap is the function that you want to evaluate. And what we actually did was we created a very simple function right here. It's a custom node, and we'll kind of look at how we can change it just a little bit. But it's going to compute the surface area. What it's going to do is take the element that we gave it, and then just based on a height value, it's going to go through and report out the surface area. So let me go ahead and open that up. This is what's inside that custom node. What's going to happen is there's a couple of different inputs. We feed it the element that we're interested in changing. We also have, in our case, this input for the height value, because that's what we want to go through and test. And the first part of this is always starts with just basically varying the element. Then we get some values out of the element. And let me kind of go back to the little mind map for a second, because that really sort of explains at a high level. Oh, this is the format we almost always use. As we're doing all these evaluations, it almost always starts out with just sort of outlining what the inputs are. Then what we do is we flex the element somehow, we change it. We say that we're going to set some parameter values, but what we need to do is use a very special construct, this transaction start and end, to go through and open the element for changing, and then after we set the parameter value, close it. And what that causes is the element to regenerate so that it will have the new value before we go out and get the result values. What happens is after we flex the element and we close the transaction, then we can go out and get the result values. That's almost always element get parameter by name. And finally, we sort of output those. So that's a very common construct we're going to use again and again. So how that looks in the map is as follows. We have the inputs. We have transaction start, set a parameter, transaction end. Okay, so always going through and doing the regeneration. In our case, the reason it knows we're changing height is because the code block says height. That's just a match for. If we choose the element, the parameter value right over here is height, so we're just matching that to the string of text. Okay, the values are going to get fed in. What happens is after we go through and set that, gonna figure out I don't want that after a while. After we set that, what we can do is go ahead and get some parameter values. So I'm gonna get the gross surface area and then just output that as the surface area. So that's our first function. Pretty straightforward. So let's go ahead and give it a run and see what it looks like. So here's the idea. I'm going to go through and with my list map, plug in 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. And for the function, what I'm going to do is pull this function, but I'm going to say grab the value that you want to see as an output of this. So I'm going to choose the element surface area. Okay. What this is doing is it will then take all these values and it will plug them into the missing hole. So since height value is the unassigned value, it'll plug those in one at a time and return the values. So let's check this out and see what it actually looks like. Okay, 10 through 50, let's give it a run. Okay, and that was actually pretty quick. You'll see that what happens is at the tail end of all this, it returns a whole series of values. Those are just the surface area values. Okay, let me go ahead and pull that back out again. Let's try it a little bit different. Let's say as opposed we're doing 10 to 50, we're doing 50 to 200. And again, I could just go ahead and give it a run. It's continuing off the top of the screen there. You see, again, I have a whole series of values down there. And that's really the essence of list map. I go through and take input values, I evaluate something, and I get a whole bunch of return values. And this is starting to look interesting, but it's not interesting enough yet. So we need to go ahead and add to this. Okay. In terms of adding to it, the very first thing I'm thinking about is, the surface area is kind of okay as a value to pull out of, but there's other values I might want to get. What if I want to get the volume? What if I want to get both? Okay, and we can go through and make that happen. Okay, it turns out it's actually pretty straightforward to get multiple values out of this thing. So right now we have this function that says just compute the surface area. Let's go ahead and grab another one. Okay, we'll put together another function that'll be even more interesting. We'll say, let's go ahead and open. and I'm going to get the surface area and volume function. Let's take a look at what the difference is. It's not really all that different. As long as you're going through the loop and grabbing one volume, you might as well, or a value, you might as well grab a bunch. Okay. This function looks so much like the other one. It's going to take those height values, going to set the parameter name, so we're going to flex it, transaction n, super. But then for getting the desired values, we're going to get the gross volume, and we're also going to get the surface area. So it's not too bad in terms of doing that. Let's come back over here. In order to make that available to me, what I'm going to do is have an output both for the get the parameter value of the volume and also the get parameter value for the surface area. So I'm going to pull them both out. Okay, and if I want to use this new improve function, let's go back over to there and let's just swap that in. As opposed to element compute surface area, if you want to element compute surface area, oh, that's looking a little narrow, I can't tell. There it is, in volume. Let's just swap this one in instead. So, if I want to get the surface area and the volume in, I'm going to pull the element and then decide really what I want, whether it's the surface area or the volume. Get rid of that one right now, I don't need that anymore. So now I can get the surface area. Okay. If I want to get the volume instead, I can go and get the volumes. So let's go ahead and pull that one out. Okay, and again, I'll go from 10 to 100 this time. Give this a little run through. So 10 through 100, you sort of see it kind of flexing away over there. What it's returning now is now the volumes as opposed to the surface areas. Okay, so let's give that a run and just sort of see how that works in the background. See if you can get that other function to work. Any luck? I'm seeing some nods. Generally working okay? Okay. So I can get one value or I can get the other value. And the way this works is list map always grabs one thing. So I have the choice of either the volume or the surface area. But you're going to say, well, that's kind of dumb. You know, I'd like to get them both. In fact, there's about four other values I'd like to get at the same time. So let's think about how you can do that. Back over here in the function, let's edit that function. Okay, I can get all the different values I want to, and I just have to sort of ultimately pull it through to an output. So I get one, I get another, I get a third, I get a fourth, and put them to different outputs. The problem is on the list map. On the list map, you only get to choose one, okay, to pull out. So how do you go ahead and beat this system? The key to getting a bunch of them out is really what you got to do is just find a way to get all the different things you want onto a single line, okay, and return that as a single entity. And then you get all the values you like. So how that works is back over here in the node, you'll see I have my two different values. What if I could, find a way to make a list out of those two values and return that list as opposed to that single value? And the thing that's going to help us out is the all-purpose, very friendly listCreate function. What listCreate allows us to do is grab those different values, okay, and make them a list. So let's talk about that. I could go ahead and grab that gross volume and make it the first item in the list. I could go ahead and grab that surface area and make that the second item in the list, and then return that as the result. So this is a little bit better. I'm even going to run this for you. Can I take a look at it? Over here, if I take this list now, as opposed to the single values, and run that, you see I get this nice little list. Ooh, okay, check it out. I got a surface area and a volume for each combination. And that's actually not too bad. I got two different values floating around in there. Now, this list is looking pretty good for the most part, but it's still lacking something that I actually would like. Because I got all these output values, but it's hard to tell really what the input value was that went with the output value. Okay, so what I would recommend doing is going one step further, and that is to go through and in this list, not only return the output values, I'll make that the first and second item instead. What I'd like to actually do is go ahead and plug in or return the input value too, just so I sort of have that one-to-one correspondence. I can kind of see them all. So what I would do is come back and take that height value, that's my input value, and actually bring that down too. Okay, by doing this, what you're just getting is little triads. So always input value and the two different output values. So you say, let's come back over here and run this. Okay, and now for every different value in there, I'm gonna watch it just do its thing for a minute. Okay, so for 50, for example, I have 7,800, 45,000. And if I go over here to this little guy, I go down to 50. You say 45,000 and 7,800. So it looks like it's internally consistent. Mm-hmm. It's doing what it wants to do. Okay, not too awfully bad in terms of what's going on over here. Yeah, it kind of gets the job done in terms of what we want. However, I was talking to someone who shall remain nameless, who was sitting in the front row during office hours, who said, hey, it sure would be nice if I could get these into an Excel spreadsheet. This is kind of ugly. You know, doing it like this is not so good looking. So can't I get them into an Excel spreadsheet? And the answer is, of course you can. So let's go ahead and figure out how to do that. That's really the last part of what we typically do. We almost always flex. We get our outputs, blah, blah, blah. We return. To get mini evaluations, we'll go through and actually do a list create and kind of put all the elements together into a list. If you want to write these values out to an Excel file, there's a great function called Excel write to file. And it has a couple parameters, but the only one you have to fill in new is file path. Let's take a look at what it looks like. So come on back over to your custom function. Let's take a look here. Actually, we don't do it there. Actually, I'll do it at the higher level. Okay, I got a list. This list looks good. 10, 90, 1,000, 3,000, and so forth. What I would like to do is actually make an Excel file out of that. So let's see if we can. The function we want to use is called Excel write to file. Let's kind of just pop that in. Okay, it's not so bad looking. The data that it's looking for is actually this data. This is, if you can picture this as being, these are groups of groups, but if you can think of each of those subgroups as being a row, actually those are columns, and the higher levels are the individual rows, okay, that's actually forming a grid, so that's how you can actually get a data grid out of this. So I'm going to say, let's send some data out. It's going to want something called file path. That is really where to put this in Excel. So if you type in file path, we can get to the function for inputting a file path. Now, file path will let you choose any file that's out there on your desktop or anywhere on your computer. I can say browse. I'm going to go just to my desktop. I'm going to say this is just session 13.1 data. In order for it to understand that it's an Excel file, though, it does want the XLS as a suffix. That'll actually help it clue in that what you're doing is creating an Excel file. Actually, that'll help Windows figure out that's what you have. So I can say that's an XLS file. Let's pull that on down here. There's a couple of other things you need. The name of the worksheet, you know how like in Excel files you can have multiple tabs that all have different names? That's where you're gonna fill that in. So I'm just gonna create a code block that says, this is my house. Uh, results. The next thing it wants is either a start and or a start row and a start column. You can offset it or just have them right at the upper right-hand corner. If you want, or upper left-hand corner, if you want it to be at A1, that's considered start row 0, start column 0. Even Excel is 0-based, like we are, which is kind of annoying. But that's the way it works. Okay, we have a sheet name. We have a start row and a start column. Let's go ahead and run this. So in theory now, when we go through and run, we get our fabulous results. They go popping on through. Let's see if I can find Excel. It's hiding in the background from me. But there we now have an Excel, just the different values. Okay. Might be nice to put a header on it. But for right now, those are the data values that are coming on through. Okay, so this whole flow of being able to kind of put in values, kind of pull out different values, and then also go through and write them out to Excel is kind of an interesting one. It actually works out pretty well. Okay. Let us think about this. Now, these are kind of nice sort of functions in terms of putting out here. We have volume, we have area, that sounds good. If you are a building scientist, if you're one of those people who think about building energy performance, sometimes people will compute a ratio between these two numbers. Okay, so if we were going to try and evaluate a building, the building shape in terms of how efficient it was and how well it was going to use energy, you know, what kind of ratio can we construct out of those? I see a building scientist. I can see a couple in the second row. That's more than that, actually. Go ahead. Like, what can we do? If we had, what's going to make sense? What can we do with area and volume that would be a sensible kind of metric of like how well the building performance might be, or how efficient the shape might be?
Same as area to volume ratio.
Yeah. You can do if we look at it that way, then we have maximum area to surface volume, or you can say volume to area. That would be sort of maximum volume to like surface area. Either way, no matter which way you look at it, you just gotta figure out which way you wanna maximize it. But let's go ahead and do that. Okay, so if you wanna go through and add some sort of formula that does something like that, we could do it back over in Excel and just put it in there, or if you wanted to actually have Dynamo compute it for us, you have various values right in here. Let's check it out. You have a volume, you have a surface area. If you would like to divide those two things together, I bet you know how to do that. Okay, I could just go ahead and put in the little divided by function. So super, which way do you want to do it? You want to do area by volume or volume by area?
There's no zeros, so it doesn't matter. So
let's do, area per volume. Okay, let's go ahead and I'll pull down the area. I'll go through and pull down the volume. This is going to give us, for each and every one of those values, a new value, which is the ratio of those different things. I can add that to the bottom of the list. Okay, and now every row will have the four different values, the input, the two different raw values, and that output. So come on back over here. Let's give it a run. Let's take a look at that and see what it's actually telling us. Actually, I think this is actually sort of heading in a good direction in terms of the way we're thinking about it. Yep. Pull that back down again. I'll go over to Excel, pop it out over there. Where did Excel go? It's over here, hiding. Basically, as this thing gets taller and skinnier, what's happening is it's becoming a sort of less and less efficient shape is really what's going to happen into it. Okay, we're having more and more surface area per the volume that's actually sort of in there. So, that'll work. That'll work in just the way you want to do that. Another way we could look at this is in terms of gross floor area. That's another way, because that's actually probably a truer metric of what you'd like. Well, let's just do that. Come on. We know how to do this. Let's go ahead and try that. Okay, so if I want to, as opposed to saying just gross volume, if I want to say gross floor area divided by the or the surface area, something like that, that's probably better. So I want to try and get the most floor area with the least amount of surface area. Okay, that makes sense. Okay, what we can do is we have our little mass over there, that our mass is like just kind of hanging out. It's not doing too awfully bad. What I can do is if I want to create floor area, you'll notice that by default, floor area is kind of blank. It doesn't show us the floor area. You might be wondering what's going on there. This mass, this shape which is just hanging around, isn't considered to have a floor area. What we need to do is actually sort of give it some different floor levels, and then it'll figure out what the floor area is at those levels. So I could go through and say, let's go to levels, under the architecture tab. Where did it go? Oh, I need to be switched to like an elevation view. Let me go ahead and add a couple more floor levels in here. If I just add some more floor levels, even if they're not necessarily used at first, what I can do is back over here, turn them all on, and what'll happen is as the mass grows to include those, it'll add in that floor level area. So now I have something I can work with. I have all these different floor levels. I have sort of a gross floor area, kind of based on these different floors. So if I was going to go through and incorporate this in instead, what I do is just go back over to Dynamo. And in my function, so you know, as opposed to doing gross volume, let me go ahead and do gross floor area. Pop that right in there. Okay. And now, we're ready to run that. So that's the essence of what we're going to do. This whole notion of really being able to do something like this to kind of vary something, and as we're varying things, grab different values, compute values between those different things, and kind of just change the input parameter, that really helps us in terms of giving us a really good toolkit to build with to be evaluating almost any form. So let's pause there for a second. This, you know, the idea was first to make it make sense on a simple box, and if the simple box makes sense, then go ahead for something a little more complicated. Okay, kind of makes sense? Beautiful.
Which yes. Menu to add levels?
Oh, what happens there is in the elevation view, so go back over to an elevation view, and then it'll be under the architecture tab. So if I go to an elevation, and then under the architecture tab, you'll find the level tool.
What's
that?
How do you get the elevation?
Oh, to create the new ones?
Again. That
menu
right there.
You
can't see
the menu.
There's
no product browser visible.
The product browser's missing. Let's take a look at what's going on your machine. It's hidden away somehow. Oh, that happens. What do we have? Okay. Let's just go under the View tab. And under User Interface, turn on Project Browser. Just someone turned it off on you.
Okay. Then I got an elevation.
Actually, open one of the elevation views. Okay, and now choose a level. And now you can, what I usually do is just grab that and do offsets. Like a 10-foot offset. Create some more. Okay, any other questions about the simple box? Yes? Combinations, but it'll it evaluates one item in the list. So if you had two things that you wanted to change, you'd kind of create a list of two different values that you wanted to change, feed that in, and then you would change them both. So you can set two different things. You just have to go ahead and feed it as a, you know, you have to create a list of those. Yeah, but you sort of understand? Yeah, okay. Question? Did I just confuse things hopelessly? No. Okay, let's go ahead and try something that's a little more exotic. So if you can, go ahead and open up like a 12 point or 13.2 instead. In 13.2, we have something that's a little more interesting. This is the twisting tower. So go for example twisting tower. Okay, so here's my twisting tower. I'm gonna shade that around a little bit. Okay, he's not too awfully bad looking right now. This is actually, it's based on the form of the Shanghai Tower. So if you go out there and take a look at that tower. And you sort of see the form out there. It is essentially a three-sided, it's like a triangle with rounded edges, but it twists on up. And this sort of optimization, this sort of playing around with the shape and the form and trying to consider really all the different variations that could be used to sort of shape that form was used to actually determine the final shape of the building. What they were looking at were they were looking at the whole notion of they wanted to get as much sort of surface area as they could in that, or floor area, excuse me. They wanted to get as much as they could in terms of encompassing that space, but they were also trying to come up with a shape that was very aerodynamic. Okay, so the shape that they came up with is this sort of twisting triangle. The reason that sort of works is, well, almost from any position that the wind might be blowing from, it never really hits a full flat surface. If you think about the problem with so many buildings, you get a big old flat surface. This is almost like an airplane wing, that it's no matter where you hit it, it always sort of wraps around. So it twists. It also goes ahead and tapers from the bottom to the top, so it gets a little bit skinnier. And they played around with an awful lot of variations in here. You know, they tried in wind tunnels, they tried it numerically to figure out what the right sort of shape is. I think the final shape, how much twist it is around 135 degrees, if I remember correctly. They actually could go further from a wind standpoint in terms of twisting it, in terms of getting in better efficiency. What happens is if you start twisting too much, then the structure gets really, really sort of complicated. So they were starting to lose it on that end. But by doing this kind of analysis, they actually managed to save about a quarter of the structural steel by just reducing the wind loads on the thing, which is pretty huge in the scheme of things. So we're going to use that as our example. And if we go back to Revit, take a look at this. This doesn't exactly look like the Shanghai Tower right now because our tower is getting a little bit fat at the top and it's kind of skinny in the middle and fat at the bottom. But we can go ahead and adjust that. If you try just playing around with this parametrically for just a second, so let me go ahead and just change, for example, right now there's these different parameters. It's a top radius, a mid radius. Oops, where's the mid radius? I have the base radius, which is down there. Mid radius is actually kind of hidden from me. Let's go ahead and fix that. I know where it's hiding. It's actually hiding in the family. So if you want to fix that with me, go ahead and let's edit the family. Just choose it. Say edit the family. This is how this thing is defined. Under properties, let me find, there's my mid rotation. There's mid radius right there. What's happening right now is it's, oh, what is it? It's just, it is the wrong type of parameter. Hang on, I'm thinking about the best way to do this. That's there. a good way to fix that for you. Because what I want to do is actually just change that type of parameter. Ah, that's what I can do. If you choose the mid radius, and we change it as opposed to being a type parameter to an instance parameter, then it'll be available to us. And if we want this to actually have kind of a nice relationship, let's say we wanted this thing to taper up smoothly from the top of the bottom. So we wanted the mid radius to always be halfway between the top radius and the bottom radius. What we can do is right here in the parameters, let's change it so that as opposed to mid radius just being any value, let's put a formula in there. And we'll just say top radius, plus base radius divided by 2. That'll just help us kind of get that nice intermediate one and have a nice twisty, nicely tapered tower like the true one in Shanghai. Okay. So, again, all I'm doing is changing the family now and changing that parameter value. So now what's happening, you'll see that if the base is 80 and the top is 60, that's going to be 70. Okay. You can test that if you want to. If you make the base 120, you'll see, and the top is still 60, then the mid is 90. But it's going to create a nice smooth kind of profile up. Another thing we can do, just if you want to sort of really kind of model the tower the way it is in Shanghai, is we could say there's a base rotation and a top rotation. We can say the mid rotation is always halfway between those two, and that way you're guaranteed to get a pretty smooth taper. So if you did that, I could say that the mid rotation is equal to, again, top rotation plus the base rotation divided by 2. And I'll kind of keep that smooth. When I'm done adjusting this, I can load it back into my project, the twisting tower. And I'll overwrite this. Okay, that's just a little closer to the actual Shanghai Tower. So we have this fabulous twisting tower. We are ready to start evaluating it. There's a couple things we could start changing about it. If you choose the tower, you'll see that we could go ahead and change the height. That's one that's available. Another one we could try is changing the rotation. That might be kind of interesting. Even the top radius, if we want to kind of decrease the amount of taper on the whole thing. But as a starting point, just try changing those manually. So let's say, the top radius was 20. It was like very skinny, like a little pyramid. Okay, I'll make it closer to 50. Or the one that's quite surprising to people is if you go through and start changing the rotation, you make that like 180, you get these really kind of interesting twisting distorted forms. I think when you look at that, you can start to see why they might not have done that, because the structure just got really complicated to try and support that. Okay. But here's the deal. Why we're sort of experimenting with this form is, as we go through and change all these things, the floor area, the surface area, the volume are changing too. Okay, but the deal is, unlike a simple box where we could have taken out our calculator and figured it out, this is actually pretty complicated about what's going on. So we'd like to be able to test all those values and really see what the effect is kind of on the tower. So if we want to go through and apply kind of a very similar sort of analysis, you actually have all the infrastructure in place. What we did for the twist or the simple box is actually going to work for the twisting tower. It's really just the same. We're going to have to adjust the parameter names just a little bit in terms of what we're putting in and getting out. But let's go ahead and see. It actually works very similarly. So I can say, let's do a little open. Oops, not open. Excuse me. We'll do a little dynamo add-in action. And if you can, open up 10.2. Where did it go? Or excuse me, 13.2. I'll somehow get myself in the right time frame. Not that. Okay, 13. Okay, let's go for the twisting tower. I'll start with a single output. The single output is, again, only looking at a single thing. If, for example, we choose our twisting tower. So I'll select my element and grab my twisting tower. Then I'm going to pull a single value. Now, in 13.2, you might notice I changed one thing on you, just a little bit different. I'm still computing the surface area, but you'll notice as opposed to just having a value that says like height to put in here, I'm actually having the value and another parameter, which is the parameter name. Okay, and what that's going to allow us to do is not only change the values we put in, but actually change which parameter we're changing. Okay, so how that works is, if you go back over into this function and give it a little edit, you'll see it's not that different as opposed to having just a single string value plugged in here as parameter name. I'm just putting an input in there. Okay, so I have a parameter to control which parameter. Okay, not to worry. If you have that, let's go ahead and just hang it all together. I'll say let's change the top height. In my case, I decided to change the top height. My little node here is going 300 to 600, varying 100 at a time. Let me make it 3,000 or 300 to 600, changing it 50 feet at a time. But I'll put that in. Oops, you could already see. So the eagle-eyed among you might have spotted I made a mistake already, because that is actually the parameter name, and that's the value we want to put in there. Oh, even I've made another mistake right there. Okay. If I do this, actually I should probably run this and show you what happens. And I feed in a function, and I feed in these, and I feed in the top height, and all that kind of stuff, it sort of gives you unpredictable results. What I want to do is actually, as opposed to feeding the list in as the test value, I'm going to feed it to the list map, and then let it feed in as the test value. That way it's going to evaluate them one at a time. So let's go ahead and pull that over here. Okay, that's the list, take you out. The function always has to have a single open element, or, yeah, a single open element that could feed it, you could feed it a list, that single open element. Okay, but let's go ahead and try running this. Okay, so again, I'll do some running. Not too awfully bad. That's given me a whole series of different, in this case, surface areas to look at. Okay. If, however, you decided you didn't want to try testing the top height, or you wanted to try something different, like top rotation, we could go ahead and pull that up instead. So if you instead want to try changing the rotation, we can pull rotation as the parameter name and the list of rotations over here. Top rotation will be the parameter name. The list of values will be over here. Let's check that out. Now that's always a possibility. What's happening here is it's basically telling me there's something about the geometry that it's just not able to go through and work with. You know, so something about this string and the top rotation, it's just not able to do that. So let me go ahead and say delete it and see if I can figure out what it is, because if I can't do it manually, then it won't be able to do it automatically. So let's see what this is going on over here. Oops. Let's see what I got over here. This is basically saying, what do I got here? This should be giving me like a 15, 30. That looks pretty good in terms of what's going on. So I don't think that's the problem. Let's go ahead and try putting that node back in there, or the mass back in there, and just sort of see if we can figure it out. Let's go to place a component. I'm gonna, oh, here's my, it's friend over there. That's the twisting rectangular mass. If you wanna play with that one instead, you can. Okay, so it's complaining there's just something it can't do. Let's see if we can figure it out. it said it didn't like 15 or some value in there. Let's just try plugging some of these in to sort of see if the top rotation is 15. That looks pretty good. 30. Hmm. 90. Seems like it's okay. Let's try again. Test parameter name is top rotation. That part's okay. Make sure I have it all hooked up right. There was something I did that wasn't hooking up right. So is it top rotation? Let's make sure I got that value right. It is. Okay, did everyone else get the error too, or am I the only one who got the error? Let's start with that. You got the error too. Let's try changing it again. Actually, I think it did it. Let me try running it again. It is doing it. It's interesting, it wanted to recreate the thing from scratch. It's still giving me a little yellow note up here, but it is doing what I wanted it to. And it's actually giving me all the values too. Intriguing. Okay, and it's giving me the values there. Now, the same infrastructure, we could rotate the single thing and kind of do that and pull out the single value. We could go ahead and pull out multiple values too. So we already did that for the simple box, but if you want to sort of see it in action for this twisting tower, go ahead and open up if you can. Go to 2A. Okay, in 2A we just have a slightly different one. This is the one that again returns either of the two values or returns the results list. So if I want to select that value, okay, and then get the results list instead and change that or change the rotation, I can. So it'll get multiple things. Oh, here's kind of an interesting thing. Watch out for this one, everyone's raw. As you're working with things, if it doesn't think anything has changed, often it won't do anything. So sometimes you'll have to do what I'll call goosing it. You just have to sort of change something upstream so that it goes ahead and reevaluates and kind of recomputes downstream. And I mean do something like this. You change some value over here. Run completely with warnings. Let's see what's going on. It looks like I see what's going on there. In this case, it is just that I have two open parameters. I need to plug that one back in.
I like your file name.
What's that?
I like the file name.
Let's give that a run. Okay, not too bad. Okay, so as you do that, you can pull these different values. It says null right now. Let's see what's going on with my result list. I don't like that. It certainly flexed it. I got type height, I got all those values in there. Oh, I know what's going on. I think I do. Well, let's take a look. Well, let's go ahead and do that. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Well, say edit that custom node. You go into the custom node, what's happening? Oh, okay, so I have the individual values, but I haven't actually connected them into the list. Thank you. So let's go ahead and do that. We will, using that same sort of procedure, we're gonna go ahead and grab the input values. Again, I just like to have them so I can see what's going on. I'll have the output value 1 and the output value 2. Okay, and then take that over to the results. Go ahead and save that away. Come back over. Super. Now, just because I'm either very foolish or a glutton for punishment.
Thank you so much.
Have fun. Because we are a glutton or just very foolish, we are going to take a look at Jacqueline's question, which is, can we do something to actually go through and put both input parameters in there? It's a good question. Okay, so let us think about how we want to do this. Okay, what we are going to do is back over here. I have my top heights. I have some values over here. Let's kind of think about this. We're going to try to create pairs, okay, and feed a list of values to this thing and then unpack the list inside the node. That'll be fine. The question is, do we want to go through and do a cross product and do all the combinations, or do we just want to like do like a single straight line where the first value here is paired with the last one there? We can do it either way. Yeah, it's kind of whatever you like.
Oh,
so you want to do all of them? Okay. Very good. So let's go ahead and see if we can figure out if we can do this. What I want to do is get pairs of things. Okay, so what I want to do, I want to do a list create, but I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do like a list cross product or something like that. Let's go see what we have. Andrew, dig in and see what we can find, because you're always good at finding these. I can definitely, if I did list create and I fed it, now that would be that and that, that. Oh, well, hang on. Is there like a cross product or something like that? If not, we'll just do the, not quite exactly. Let's see what else we got. Vector cross. So I'm thinking I might have to sort of bring them together and then do some sort of list transpose thing. But, what I want to do is get the first item from one, the first item from another, and pull them together. So, interesting.
Is there this map thing you could do with that?
We could create a function that kind of takes those two different things. Well, no, then it's every combination and every combination. Then you're sort of just doing it within. And it's a good question because there aren't for loops. That's the hard part in terms of that. The list map is the closest thing we have to a for loop. I'm trying to think, because I just want to create pairs. You have a code block there, you got a code block there. It's a string of those. I feel like list combine. Appends a applies a combination. Well, that's the combinator where we can go through, but that's not exactly what I want either. Well, independent of how we're actually going to create that list, let's go ahead and just kind of create a list and then like go from there in terms of pairs, because there's a whole other issue about how we can create that effectively. What I want to do is basically kind of create a list of basically lists. So what you want to do is almost go through and put these in sort of like funny values. Like I could say, let's do 250, comma, like 15. That's one list. I can do, actually even here, this would be a list of lists. Let's say it's 300, comma, 30. And finally, 350, comma, 45. Again, we'll need to come up with a better way of doing this, but I think that gives us essentially what we need. Is that true? That is not true. What is going on there? I got my brackets. What's going on? Can I not do brackets that way? That's what I usually think of as doing lists. Just sort of null right there.
Mine worked.
Yours works?
Yeah.
You have to run it? There we go. Okay, if you could suspend disbelief on how we need to go through and create that using these two different arrays, and I suspect that Andrew's right, there's going to be some sort of a custom node we're going to do. We're going to take these two different strings and do the cross product for them, something like that. But what we can do now is feed this in. If this is my list of values that are in my input values, let's go ahead and go into our custom node and see if we can mess with it. Edit custom node. Okay, because I'm going to edit this custom node and do something horrendous to it, what I'm going to do is do a save as, just because I want to keep the old one around, because I kind of like the old one. So let's do a little save as action. Where should you save it? The best place is to save it in the same folder where you've been doing your work. So go ahead. Okay, I'll say this from pairs. Okay, let's take a look and see what we can do with this thing now. So, the idea is now, as opposed to bringing in a single list test value, you're basically going to bring in basically a pair of values. So what's going to happen is, in that list, just so you sort of think about it in terms of the list mapping, what's going to happen is each item in that list is going to come through one at a time. So the first pair, or the first item in the list is going to have 20, 250 and 50 in it. The second one's going to have 320, 30, or 330. So they're going to come through as basically a list of two items. So, okay, what I'm going to change that to say is just input value list. And even in here, I can say test parameter name. I'm just sort of making this a little bit nicer. There, and I'm going to copy that and paste that down, just so I could have test parameter name too. So those are all my inputs right now. I'm going to have input value list and a test parameter name one and a test parameter name two. Okay. As I go through and do the setting, what I want to do is as follows. I want to, between the transaction start and the end, I want to set one of them kind of based on the first value, the second one based on the second value. So what I'm going to do is do this. If I say list get item at index, okay, and the first one I'm going to get is at item index 0. The second one is going to be at index 1. What I can do is feed in the list. Okay, and now those are the two different values I want to use. Okay, what I can then do is give myself another element set parameter by name. So I'm gonna have two of these. Now, in terms of my second one, just so you can get it all hung together, right? Oops, I don't want to copy the whole group. Copy that node, paste that node. What I want to do is as follows. For the first one, I'm going to get input parameter 1. I'm going to get the value is going to be item 0. Okay. For the second one, I'm going to get the item name number 2. And it's going to be value at index 1. Okay. So far, so good? You sort of roughly understand what I'm up to? Okay, super. As I go, though, what I would really like to do is grab and make both those changes to the element. So as opposed to saying transaction start end and then transaction start end twice, every time you say end, it's going to regenerate. And that causes Revit to flash and do whatever it's supposed to be doing and regenerate the object there. So it's actually more efficient to sort of set one, then set the other, and then do the transaction end. So make both of the input value changes and then say, okay, you're the new object that has those two different parameter changes. So what I'm going to do is just slip the element right in here and then do the transaction end there. That got a hmm and an oh.
I was not expecting that.
I made this combiner. It's messy.
Oh, did it actually do what went on?
I think I made it combined.
Okay.
I'm not 100% sure that it properly crossed them, but it involves some list cycling and then list combining with a list joiner.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Andrew's going to have the custom node for us by the end of the break. Okay, so we take that element, we go through and we say, great, the first parameter is going to be changed by the first, or the zeroth item in the list. The second element or parameter is going to be changed by the first item in the list. Set one, two, transaction, then we can still get those things. So I am sorry if that's hopelessly complicated it, but it's actually, that's the answer. We're looking at you, Jacqueline.
And it's easier to write a script for it.
What's that? Yeah, that's probably true. Okay, so let's check this out. Let's go ahead and save that one away. That's such a good looking node. I like that node. Okay, and we'll come back over and use it. We'll come back over here. And now we have the top type is parameter number one, or the, actually it should be test parameter name zero and one. I would be really proper about this. The second one's going to be top rotation. And here's the part that breaks it all. We take that list, and we bring in the list of pairs. OK, so sort of makes sense, more or less.
Mm-hmm.
Top height is the test parameter. That's going to the zeroth element. Rotation's going to the second one in every pair. I think this will actually work. Oh, that's entirely possible. Let's see where it, yeah, again, I probably broke things. Let's see where it sort of breaks. Okay, can't make type. That's a good one. Let's go ahead and do a little watching. Watching is an all-purpose popular thing. So see, are we reading it properly? Because if we don't kind of get it all read in properly, yeah, we're going to still have these troubles. It's interesting. It's trying to do something back there. Lord knows what. Okay. Let's do a little watching. Well, even, what did it come up with here? Oh, that's really weird looking. Can you see it's inverted on itself? Okay, let's see what's happening to this thing. Top height is 45.
Mid height isn't controlled.
Oh! Okay. Even though, am I rotate? It looks like I have the order wrong. It looks like it's doing the top height, and what's the top rotation? Is 90? Somehow I'm definitely reading things wrong. Because in terms of this instance, what do I got? I got my top height of 45. I have my top rotation of 90, which seems like, I expect it to be 45. I'm definitely sort of messing up in here somewhere, right? So let's figure out why. It should be height, and it should be that, but you know. Why is top height 45? But there's only one way to figure out. Let's go back into our custom node, and here's what we gotta do. Is back over here, let's do a little looking around. The problem with custom nodes is you can't actually see inside them very well. You have all these kind of funny values and stuff like that, but all that little preview stuff isn't available. So what you gotta use instead is this, the ever popular watch node. Let's see if we can figure this out. So we're going to go through and we're gonna start by just watching the input value list. You're gonna find when I'm debugging, I just tended to put watches on a little bit of everything because I'm just not sure where it went wrong.
Yeah.
And what I'll usually do is start towards the front and just kind of work my way through and see if we can sort of figure out what's going on. Set parameter name, that should be good. And then we got that. Let me just try running this and sort of see. I just want to see, are we getting the right sort of pairing of the parameters to values? Okay. Because you never quite sure. Okay. Let us see what we have. Oh, when you are running in this mode, you need to get back to the run button. The run button is not on this the custom node. It's actually back out in the main Dynamo graph. So ways you can get at it, I think what I usually do is F5. Let me try and see if that'll work. Maybe not. Used to be F5 worked. Run workflow F5. Do I have to do it out here? Oh, I should have said cancel. Let's try that again. Da, 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 da. Place that thing.
When you give it a list and tell it to get item at index, does it choose, like which, if it's a list of lists, which index does it choose?
It should. What should happen is the list map should be passing in the first element, or the first list, which is the list of the two values.
Okay.
That's what I'm expecting. But that's where I'm expecting it's probably messing up. So let's go and see if we can figure out why. Okay, so again, I'm gonna say run. Still got that funny inverted shape. Let's see if we can figure out why it has that funny inverted shape. Oh, that's interesting. Input value list, it's in, that's interesting. Okay, this is getting the 45 in there. The first item is 45, that is null. So can I get an input value list? I think I ought to be able to, but let's think about why not. It's not doing that. It's not doing that. That'd be very weird that it can't do a list within lists. I'd be perfectly willing to believe it can't do that, at which point it's going to pass them in as like kind of pairs with commas in them or something like that. It certainly is not doing anything. It just finally did that for 45. That is very strange.
Okay.
Not to worry. So it just did that. It's almost like it flattened the list out completely when it did what it did. Which I don't like very much, but not to worry. Let's go ahead and kind of work on that. If I said that as opposed to being this, oh, what do I want to do here? It's going to get me in a funny hole in terms of doing it there, in terms of the values, yada, yada, yada. I just want them to be that. I'm trying to think of a good way to do this, short of just kind of messing around a little bit. Try this. Okay, is it, it's not concatenate. There's one where I put the strings in. It's list. It's like concatenate, but it's different. That just joins in there, string join. Okay. Let me try this. What if I took, oh, this might actually work. Let me take that list right there. And that list right there. Put as the separator. We're really good off script now, so. This has me wondering though, because I have lacing again. Woohoo, who knew? No? Oh, it's not that one. I want to go this one. Gonna take off my list map for right now. Still null. I'm gonna just join those. It kind of hurts. Well, as opposed to trying to do it smartly, let's just change this. What I'm doing is just passing him in as a series of strings. Again, I don't think this is a great way to do it. But I just want to see if we can kind of get this to some. I'm gonna think about this. There's gotta be another way to do this. That's okay. I could take this list and basically pop that list up to the list map right there. At which point, now I got those little paired strings. Damn, we created a list of lists again. Let's see what this is doing. What did you do? Oh, there it is. Okay. So I got these little pairs that have the commas in them. Okay, I'll take that. Let's go back over here. If we were gonna go back into our function now, and say that as opposed to getting first item, getting last item, basically we have a string that has a comma in it. So how can we go ahead and take something that has like a string that has a comma in it and just break it into two chunks? We'll just get rid of some of these.
Split?
Yep, string.split.
Okay.
I found it.
Excellent. Into a list of strings. Check that out. Ooh, I like that. Okay, let's try this. We'll say that we're gonna split our string. Based on a nice separator, so I'll take this list right there. Our separator should be now, get a little comma action. Okay. let's go ahead and watch this one just to make sure that that's actually giving us back what we want. That shouldn't, we think, now give us a list of two different items. Oh, I probably should have kept listing the first time. Okay, let's go ahead and just run this. Ah, very nice. There's always more than one way to beat this. At which point I probably should have kept around the list skip first item and list skip last item, because that's actually what we're going to do now. So by basically taking the string and breaking, splitting the string, as suggested, I could now actually take that and say list skip first item and list skip second. Why did I erase that? Okay, index there, index there. Get that list. Get that list. Take that item here. This first one, the zeroth one, we decided to be the value that goes in here. The first one we decided to be the value that's going in there. Do we trust this? Probably not, but we're gonna try anyway. Okay, let's go ahead and come on back. I'm list mapping, I'm taking those fabulous looking strings in. I am trying to run this. What's it doing? It says run completed. I am thinking that it probably is just needing to be goosed, which is my little thing about sort of restarting it. No, I got that, I got that. Why are you not doing anything? Set parameter. Set parameter. Sure looks like it should be doing something. Let me try this. Not doing anything. Actually, it's giving me values. Null and null. Oh, that's interesting. Okay, well, didn't do a whole lot of flexing. It went through and definitely understood those input values there, but it says null and null on that. So let's go ahead and see. You can sort of see it is feeding the values in. Let's see what's happening in terms of breaking this down. If I edit the custom node again. Transaction start, set parameter name. Just watch that one. Get parameter name, gross area, gross volume. That should be fine. You try writing that. When all else fails, then we'll continue to debug offline. Still says null. Let's go back and sort of see what we're at least watching. Says null. Okay. You sure look like a list, and your zeroth value seems to be 350, but it's coming up null. That one looks like it's not getting anything either in terms of its first value. It sure looks like a list. I don't know. We will debug and trying to figure out where things are going wrong. It's just like, it seems like that ought to be able to get it. Looks like a list, looks like values. But the fact that that's actually getting null, the list get item and index, sure looks like zero. Anyone see any weird errors? Okay, not to worry. Let us try, move it along a little for you in terms of the next example. Wish that one had a better answer, but oh well, so much for going off script. Okay, let's go ahead and use ListMap in a slightly different way. What we want to do is, back in old Solar Analysis Land, you might remember in Solar Analysis Land, we could go ahead and create a whole bunch of a surface and evaluate it, but if you actually wanted to use that solar analysis function not to evaluate the entire surface, but to evaluate a whole series of panels and evaluate them independently. And this won't be that different than computing the directness values, it's just going to be more accurate, because you're still going to go through and take a surface, we'll subdivide it, and as opposed to saying here are the surface normals, let's just kind of feed that surface into the solar analysis function and figure out the insulation values on the surface. Give yourself a better looking number over there. So that's where we're going for this one. We're just, again, going to really go through and evaluate and just kind of see if we can get sort of better numbers here. Okay, so for this one, if you can, open up, where is it? Let's go to 13.3. This is a panelized surface. Now, in terms of the surface, this is actually the same as the sine wave. Remember that little rolling sine wave kind of thing that we were looking at last time? In this case, I've broken it down into a whole series of different panels and even colorized them. But let's go ahead and eliminate this and kind of, what we're trying to get to is basically, as opposed to thinking about the value of the overall surface, just thinking about on that surface, if we had panelized it, really, could we do the evaluation based on the true insulation as opposed to the directness vectors? So that's what that map is looking at right there. And if I take that out, just so that we are starting from scratch, and go to Dynamo, let's do a little add in and out, put it all together. Let's open 13.3, and let's start with just panelizing the surface. If you can, open up 1A. Looks like I have some missing nodes hanging around in here. If that is the case, what I need to do is actually just go through and copy some nodes back in. It looks like the nodes that I'm missing in particular is, I have that node which created the sine wave curve. So if that's missing, what I can do is copy it into the folder, or I can even open it if I want to. Let me say yes, and oh, where it exists right now, you'll find it in 13.4. Curve, sine waves, and amplitude. So this is actually the node, and what we're doing in here is, just up here, we're just generating that kind of funky curve. So let's start with that. Go ahead and see if you can kind of generate that curve, and we'll see how that works. So again, just based on kind of some sine wave parameters for the middle, the front, and the back curves, we're just going through and varying some sine wave curves and also lofting them. Okay, so is that part good? Okay, that's kind of where we were last time. Let's go down into the next kind of chunk of code in here. What we're going to do is basically say that, hey, we would like to panelize this surface. So in terms of that, there's the idea that we have some sort of like a seamless panel. We can go ahead and use that or one of the other panels. We have a number of panel rows and a number of panel columns. And there's really just some code to kind of string it all together. So what I'm trying to do is basically just take that surface. What I'm going to do is, there's a number of different kind of really cool functions. A really nice one is called surface divide surface by U into UVs, where if you give it a number of U's and a number of V's and you feed it a surface, it'll give you the points that we can quad. So let's go ahead and work with this one. There's another one down here you can do under lunchbox, which is a quad grid by face. It actually does kind of the same thing. So it's either surface, divide surface UV and get the points, or you get the points over here from the panels. They kind of come in slightly different points, so let's take a look at them both. So let's start by grabbing the surface and using the first function to panelize it. So I got the surface, it's right over here, my nice lofted surface. Drag it on down. What you might notice about this function actually goes through and it's computing points at the corners of the UVs, as opposed to the middle of the UVs. Okay, so you can sort of see the normals kind of floating around in there, but we can take those points, we can quad them and flatten it out, and then place some panels. And if we do that back over in here, you'll see I now have some panels that are approximating that curve. Now, the number of panels you work with versus the fineness of the curve have to sort of be in sync with each other. At 4 panels by 6 panels, this is a pretty poor approximation, okay? But it's expedient. It's kind of quick for our computational purposes. But what we want to do is kind of up that up a little, you know, higher so that the actual panels do a better job of following the sine wave curves. Right now it's just kind of a little bit rough right now. But we can go through and panelize them. That's our first step in terms of doing this. I think that it actually would work the same if we went the other way. If we went down here and we took the surface and instead mapped it into that other function, the lunchbox function, I think we'd also be okay. The point is really that there's often more than one way to get at something. So you just gotta think of which strategy you wanna use. Well, there often are sort of back-end implications to the whole thing. And we take that surface out. Okay, this is again giving us points, bunches of quad points. So if I flatten these out, apply them, I think I pretty much get back to the same place. It's not really that different. This is two different functions for getting to the same place. Okay, so it's all starting just by panelizing. So let's just kind of pause there for a second in terms of panelization. I think that for most of you in terms of the assignment and what's going on, you're taking your thing, you're panelizing it. Oh, let me make it like even 8 of them versus 4. We'll rerun that. And hopefully I'll get something that looks a little bit finer. Oh, that's interesting. You know, this is kind of a funny thing. Watch out for this. 8 actually matches the number of sine waves, so I'm always falling at the even. Yeah, so that's not very good. What if I changed it to 9? Okay, that's probably a little bit better. Okay, so start by panelizing. If you are panelized and you're looking good, you are ready to go ahead and start evaluating. So here's the deal. You could think about all those different panels in there as ultimately being surfaces. Okay? You might remember our old solar radiation analysis tool. It's gonna go through and basically look for surfaces. And if you feed it the overall surface, it gives you an overall evaluation for the entire thing. If you wanted to do it panel-wise, just do it panel at a time, what we need to do is feed it a list of panels, or a list of surfaces, as opposed to one big surface. So we're gonna go ahead and swap that on in. So to do that, if you can, open up. Let's go for 2A. And we'll talk about how we can do this. What I want to do is I want to go through and create a whole bunch of surfaces. Okay. And as I go through and compute those surfaces, what I would like to do is basically take these panels that I've subdivided up and actually make each of those into a surface. I have the overall wavy surface, the lofted surface, and I'd like to go through and create a bunch of individual surfaces. So one function which is very useful is from those quad points which we have gone through and used to place the adaptive components, we can go ahead and make a surface out of the points. If you give it a perimeter, it'll go through and make a surface that sort of uses all those points as the perimeter of it. Okay, so if you look at this function, which should be happening if you run it, is we should get, based on the total number of kind of grids that we put together, we should get a list of surfaces, like 24 or 28 or 32 or whatever it is, based on how many I've sort of subdivided the surface into. That should be, I believe, just part of the core. Is it not on yours?
If it says unresolved and it's yellow, that means it's not.
Right? Let's see if anyone else had it. Like, I'm not sure if it came from a package. I didn't think it did, but let's sort of see.
It does say blend cats package lunchbox for dynamo.
Interesting. So that it knows that in that it did. Just go ahead and let's do a search in here. Is anyone else able to find it? Let's say surface dot. Nothing there. So maybe it did come from Lunchbox from Dynamo. Go ahead and install that. Say yes. The problem is Lunchbox is such a great package of utilities. It's such a good, that we sort of keep on using things all over the place trying to just because there's a lot of things that are sort of useful.
I think it's just this computer. I don't have
it. Okay, is it in there? Surface now.
Yeah.
There it is.
Cool.
It does come out of Lunchbox.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, no worries. So, I'll apologize for that. That actually came out of the Lunchbox kind of list of utilities. Another one I highly recommend kind of installing. So, if we go through and divide our surface, and then we say surface by perimeter points, I wonder if that's a Lunchbox one too. Okay. I must have loaded that one in. Here, by perimeter point, okay, that looks like it's part of the core geometry, so that's okay. So, if I bring these on down, I have a whole bunch of surfaces. I have a nice array of all these different surfaces. So what's gonna happen now is, when I go through and I try to feed it into the solar analysis, I'm going to have 24 different surfaces, and it's going to give me 24 different grids of points, like for all of those different surfaces. But here's what I want to get you to do, where I want to think about how we can go through and use like list mapping to our advantage. Sometimes I use list mapping to go through and just sort of vary the overall parameters on something. It's all about create a function, change some variables, stuff like that. Another perfectly valid use of list map is to go through and, for all of these surfaces, evaluate them one at a time and compute and return a value for each of them. Okay, so how that's going to work is, in our solar analysis, what I would like to do is basically take all of those different surfaces into a list. I'd like to feed it a function which really has the solar analysis kind of nodes built within it. And that's what this one is, surface solar analysis cumulative values. This is just a custom node that I created by grabbing all that solar analysis infrastructure and throwing it into a custom node that just really had an input to it. So if I come over and edit that custom node, you'll see it still has solar analysis analyze. It has an input for the analysis surface, the weather, the time study, spacing and project rotation, I'm leaving this set at zero right now. But by doing something like this, what I'm going to do is basically just feed in individual surfaces, evaluate those, and get a grid on that one surface. And then for that one surface, just go through and compute. In this case, I computed the cumulative, the highest. I computed the average of all those values, and I also computed the sum of those values. So three different sort of functions to go through and compute different things. Here's all the grids on that one individual surface. Okay. So by using this function and computing it together, what I can do is go through and just ultimately return either the max, the average, or the sum of all the solar insulation values for a single panel, and then ListMap is going to go ahead and do it for all the panels. Okay. So to finish, let's come over here. And if I ListMap all those panels and this function together and give it a big old run, what's going to happen is, in this case, it's giving me, for the 24 different panels, it's giving me the maximum value, okay, for the radiation. So it's just a way of taking something that we do on an entire structure and breaking it down so you can do it on a panel by panel basis. And the key is really just make a list of the elements you want to evaluate and feed it into the function so you can evaluate them one at a time. So with the results, you can still do whatever you want to kind of do in terms of interpreting them. Whether we want to sort of go through and compute an overall total for all the panels or an average for all the panels to evaluate the strength of the shape, we can do that. In this case, I'm just basically mapping them to that blue to red range so you can sort of see in the structure back in the background, you know, kind of what the issue is in terms of the colors back over there. But the idea of this whole exploration is really, we're trying to say that we're at a high level changing some parameters about a surface, and then we want to go through and evaluate just the strength of that form, okay, either by looking at kind of an overall evaluation or looking at a panel by panel evaluation. Okay. Both of them are sort of valid ways of looking at it. The overall evaluation would be good from the standpoint of saying, let's go ahead and kind of choose the overall twist that is the best form, or the overall curvature is the best. The panel by panel variation evaluation would be good for saying, for the individual panels you're putting on them, how you should adapt their parameters, just to sort of to take advantage of the insulation that's available kind of at that surface. Okay, so a combination of the two is really the strongest. Okay, you want to play ahead? Go ahead and look at 13.4. That's really just looking at changing the overall waviness of the surface and using a list map to go through and change different degrees of project rotation. So, you know, you could either sort of change the number of waves, or change the rotation, or change the length of it, but changing the overall form a little bit using the list map by kind of the variance of the parameters. Okay, but all of these things combined kind of work together to give you the ability to evaluate different surfaces. The overall form, panel by panel, so you can then come back in and I can make some recommendations. In terms of the assignment, let's finish up there. Many people have asked for an extension to go ahead and keep on working on it until Thursday. So if that fits your schedule, feel free to go ahead and take advantage of that in terms of getting it done. But use it judiciously, because like everything else, if you don't get it done tonight or the next day, it just kind of builds up, and you know, then tomorrow's bad, or Thursday's bad, or you know, so try to use the leniency and the leeway and all that to schedule things well relative to everything else you have to do, but don't get yourself in trouble just by putting it off. Okay, and then we'll have office hours again tomorrow in the afternoon, and I don't know. We'll see what's going on Thursday. But definitely we'll be here tomorrow afternoon, kind of playing around. Giving some guidance. Okay.
I fixed 13.2.
Fantastic!
Made it work with this. So it's all up in AP60.
In terms of doing it with the points?
In terms of making the lists go.
Yes. Oh, fantastic. I will download that and see. Okay, thank you, Andrew. You knew he would. Okay, excellent. Thank you, and we will adjourn for today.
So I wasn't exactly watching what you were